So the next reading, BSM model, Black-Scholes and Menten model. The learning outcomes in this reading, let's have a quick look at them. First, we will look at the log normal property of stock prices, distribution rate of return and calculation of expected return, realized return and historical volatility. This concept is important from a testability perspective. Assumptions under BSM. And then calculation of value of European option using the BSM on a non-dividend paying stock. Then what complications would be involved while valuing warrants. Then the concept of implied volatilities. How dividend would affect the valuation of call and put, especially if it's an American option. Then how do we take decisions about the exercise. And then the valuation of European option using BSM if it is a dividend paying stock. And then finally the black model. First learning outcome. Now before we jump on to the learning outcome, let's do some background. Okay. So the first concept is, how does continuous compounding work? Let us say we have an asset whose value right now is 150. This is a valuation at time 0. At time 0.5, that is half of the year, this asset has become 107. How do you find out continuously compounded rate of return per annum? Can you do this? Please try doing it. In half of the year, 100 rupee asset or $100 asset has become 107. What would be continuously compounded rate of return per annum? So what you would want to do here is, log normal 107 divided by 100, but this will give you the returns for half of the year. So you'll have to annualize that by multiplying with 2. So let's do it on your calculator. On the Texas Instrument professional calculator, 107 divided by 100, that essentially will give you 1.07. Then press the log normal button. So that will give you 6 point something. Correct? 0.06 something. Now multiply this with 2 because we've got half of the year, so we annualize this. So this would be 13.5%. Now without any calculation also you could have guessed, in 6 months you're earning 7. So in 1 year you should be earning 14. But since it's continuous compounding, the answer has to be less than 14. Now let us say that at time 0, valuation is 100. At time 2.5, valuation is 137. Find out continuously compounded rate of return per annum. So the keys that you would want to use here, log normal 137 divided by 100. But this time to annualize, we will divide by 2.5. How much is that? 9%. Let us say time 0, your value is 100. Continuously compounded rate of return per annum is 17%. What would be the value, future value at time 1.7 years? What would be the future value at time 1.7? So now the keys you would want to use here, you will say 100 multiplied with e raised to, because you would take the exponential function. 17% into 1.7, and that will give you 133.5. Are you comfortable with this now? Fair enough. So now the Black-Scholes formula. This Black-Scholes formula is essentially used to find out value of an option. The standard formula works only on European options. So the value of call option is equal to, now the easier way to remember formula is, create a hypothetical example. Let us say strike price is 100, spot price is 150. The value of call option here is about 50, which is calculated as 150 minus 100. So what we have done here is, we have said spot minus the strike. Right? This is essentially the value of call. Now, this strike, we have to take a present value of this. So this strike we will multiply with e raised to minus rt, so that we get the present value of that strike. And then what binomial model essentially does, it introduces probability into this formula. Okay, so this is spot, and strike into e raised to minus rt is nothing but simply the value of a bond, a zero coupon bond, which is present value of strike. So to the spot we will multiply with nd1, and to the strike we will multiply with nd2, n being the normal distribution value. Then the formula for d1, first we will take the distance between spot and strike, so log normal spot divided by strike, plus time adjusted half of variance added with RFR divided by sigma into root t. Then d2 would be d1 minus sigma into root t. And once you have d1 and d2, you take nd1, nd2, you put them into this formula, you would get value of the call option. Is that fine? Now, how do you find out value of put option using Black-Scholes? Either you remember separate formulas, or alternatively, just use put call parity. Okay, so you can find out value of call option, use put call parity, find out value of put option. So we know that put call parity is stock plus put, which is same as bond plus call. So put option would be bond, and bond is nothing but strike price multiplied with e raised to minus RT, the present value of strike price, plus the value of call option minus the value of stock, and this will give you value of put option as per Black-Scholes model, as long as you are entering call option value from the Black-Scholes model. Are we clear with this? So let's do an example. Let us say spot is 1000, risk-free rate of return, nothing is mentioned, assume continuous, 7%, annualized volatility 5%, now let me keep it lower, annualized volatility 4%, expiry 1 year, strike price of the call option 850. Find out value of this call option using Black-Scholes and Melton model. Let's do it together. Step number 1, we will solve for D1. Log normal, spot is 1000 divided by 850 plus expiry is 1 year, so 1, variance would be 4% square. When you take the square, you have to be careful that you are taking square of a percent, 0.04 square divided by 2 plus risk-free rate of return, which would be 7%, divided by sigma 4% multiplied with root 1. So on your calculator, let's do this together. 1000 divided by 850, 1000 divided by 850 ln, so that should be 0.4647. Yeah, sorry, 0.1 16. So that's how do you read this number? The distance between spot and strike is about 16.25%. So let that number remain as it is. Put that in the first memory slot, STO1. Then 4% x square. 4% x square divided by 2 plus 0.07 equal to STO2. So we have this number in the first memory slot, this number in the second memory slot. Now you would say RCL1 plus RCL2, RCL1 plus RCL2 equal to divided by 0.04 equal to 5.8. And since this value is substantially more than 3, your ND1, we know that in a normal distribution, 99.9% values are plus or minus 3. So your ND1 is, we will take this as 99.5%. Is it fine? Then calculation of D2, and it makes sense because this ND1 in Black-Scholes is nothing but delta of the call option. And one easier way of reading delta of a call option is, just for your understanding purpose, in a slightly loose language, probability that option will be in the money. Probability that option will be in the money. So there is a 99.5% chance that on expiry this option would be in the money. D2. This 99.5 you get from the table, normal distribution table, but generally the values are between plus and minus 3 standard deviation. So if you have a value more than 3, it is almost 100% probability. It can never be exactly 100%, but it can be close to 100%. D2 would be D1. D1 is 5.8 minus 0.04, so that would be 5.76, and therefore again D2 is going to be 99.5%. Now once you have D1 and D2, then we can calculate value of call option. So first, spot is 1000. Spot is multiplied with ND1, so that's 99.5% minus present value of 850. So 850 multiplied with e raised to minus 7%. And then once you have the bond, this again we will multiply with 99.5. So value of option would be more than 150. So value of the call option using the Black-Scholes model is coming out to be 206. Is that fine?